I said, my name is Leonard Rosenthol. My role at Adobe is as the PDF standards evangelist, which basically means that it's my job to maintain the purity, the standardization, and the functionality of PDF both throughout Adobe and also going out to the world. And I'll mention that a little bit throughout the presentation. So, PDF, portable document format, it's been around now for about 14 years. Long time. Of course, we started with version 1.0. We're currently on version 1.7. And it has been, up until this past January, an open published specification, which basically means that Adobe controlled it. We did whatever we wanted to it, but we always published, either electronically or in physical book form, the actual specification, and it was anybody was able to do what they wanted with it. However, in January, we announced, and in fact, these last 2 days, which is why I just flew in this morning, was the first meeting of the International Standards Organization, ISO. We have turned PDF over to ISO to be a full international open standard. So Adobe will no longer control PDF, but it will now be controlled by the International Standards Body. And if any of you are interested in participating, we certainly welcome your participation in the future of PDF and things that you'd like to see incorporated into the PDF language and the PDF process going forward. So that said, what's in there? Probably a lot of things you didn't expect, but we'll go over them. Some of them probably in a little more detail than others. The core PDF is certainly what we historically called the PostScript imaging model, because it was originally based on Adobe's PostScript. And today we refer to it as the Adobe imaging model, because we've advanced it beyond what PostScript is capable of, specifically in things such as transparency, additional compression, and imaging algorithms, and we'll talk about some of those. Bitmapped images, raster images, in addition, of course, to text and vectors. Prepress features, if you're trying to produce a document for certain types of separated high-end workflow devices, we have trapping, we have bleeding, and overprinting and such. Navigation tools. You don't just want static paper anymore. This is certainly true of documents that you're producing to be read online, not just to be printed. You want bookmarks, you want hyperlinks, you want all of those things that are going to make your document intelligent, easy to work with, able for the user to manipulate and get around them in the ways that you expect. Annotations, you can mark up your document, you can add all sorts of things, think of it as a layer on top of your content, with all sorts of different ways that you can expose and comment on what's going on. In addition, we've also added, and I'll talk a little more about this, multimedia capabilities over the years so that your documents can actually speak for themselves, display movies, present 3D, even in real time. We have a full forms capability, security and authentication, and certainly even more. And we'll go through these in more detail. There we go. What's not in there, though? PDF, this is a common misconception, and I like to get it dealt with right off the bat. PDF is not PostScript, never has been. The only thing that they have ever shared, the only thing they have ever shared is the philosophy and that imaging model. PostScript is and remains a programming language. It's actually based on an old language called Forth, okay? And it's a wonderful language for what it does and as far as it's gone. But it doesn't address the needs of PDF, which was the idea of a document that could be randomly accessed. PostScript has the problem that if you want to get to page 53, you first have to process page, which is 1 to 52. And for a viewable document, an on-screen document, that was something that was unacceptable for our needs as we went through that. Certainly, PostScript does not know about anything that doesn't print. You can't feed a 3D object to PostScript and expect it to come out of your laser printer. Okay, it's just not going to happen. It's not been updated in a long time. I think it's been about 10 years now since we released PostScript Level 3 in terms of a language. We've certainly, as Adobe's implementation of PostScript, we've added capabilities on top of the language, like support for PDF and such. But the language itself is unchanged for 10 years. So let's talk a little bit. This is actually as far into the guts of PDF as I'm going to go in this presentation, but just to give you an idea, a PDF file is actually four different pieces if you were to kind of break it apart. There's the header, which identifies, hey, this is a PDF, and this is probably what version of PDF I am. So if you could actually look at one, if you opened it up in a little editor, you'd actually see it start with percent PDF dash and a version number. And then it's actually followed by another line, which we lovingly refer to as the garbage bytes of a PDF. Those two lines are the header. Following that, up until almost to the end, is the body, and I'll talk about that in a second. The bottom two pieces, though, are somewhat more important in some ways than the body. They are the cross-reference table and the trailer. The cross-reference table is actually the brains behind that PostScript PDF dichotomy. It's a way to find very quickly every object in the PDF file, and so it's what gives the PDF its random access nature. And the trailer is things we want to know about that document before we open it. How many objects are in there? Is it encrypted? Sorts of pre-opening types of information. And then the body is all of your objects. So if you actually open up the PDF reference, which is, you know, the document that we produced historically to document PDF, these are the seven things that we've chosen, that Adobe's chosen, as the key features of PDF. So let me go through them. And I'll go through them somewhat briefly. The imaging model we've talked about, this is how we put paint to paper, if you will. This is also resolution independent vectors, it's text, it's all the things you have come to know and love about PDF. Plus, back in PDF 1.4, Acrobat version 5, we introduced transparency and opacity to the model, and that's when we broke that PostScript equals PDF model, was with that version. I'll give you a very complex mathematical equation. If you ever need to relate the version of PDF to the version of Acrobat, we do a special thing we call addition. 1 + 4 = 5. So Acrobat 5 was the version that shipped with 1.4. And that also works. The transitive property of mathematics applies as well. Acrobat 6 equals version 1.5. So if you ever need to do it, you now know how. All right, portability. This is something that today we actually take for granted. But if you go back, those of you who are computing back in the early 90s will remember that the idea of a file format that was the same on both Macintosh and Windows was unheard of. Microsoft Word for Mac and Microsoft Word for Windows used two different file formats. The same thing was true with Photoshop. With every other program really that existed at the time, two different file formats on the platform. So when Adobe came out with this file format that was the same across the board, it was just unheard of, and that was a big key thing. Obviously, it's a portable document format. It needs to work everywhere. That also meant that we needed to address the portability of language. And so over time, originally we did not use Unicode. Unicode didn't really exist, hadn't had the popularity at the time. But since then, we have fully addressed Unicode throughout the PDF system. And so you've got all those capabilities, which means your languages, your text, all of your content is portable as well. One of the things that is also special at PDF, and we'll talk a little more about this, is the idea that as you incorporate all of your content into the document, you want that content to be secure and authenticated. You want to make sure that the person reading it is the right person and not the wrong person, that it can only go to certain individuals, and that those people know for without a doubt that you were the one who sent it and nobody's modified it since it was sent. And to that end, we've introduced a variety of secure algorithms of encryption, digital signatures, and of course you want small documents, and so we also, of course, take advantage of all of the standard compression. And this is all industry standard. We've invented nothing here. You can go through these names, everything on this list, and it's all the things that somebody else in the industry invented. Everybody else said, this is good, and we've taken in and adopted it and put it to use. Font independence. Again, those of you who are around in the early 90s may remember that PDF was not the only game in town. There were actually other companies and other formats that got into the portable document game. At the time, Novell had a product called Envoy. There was something called Common Ground, Hummingbird software, a couple of other things. Obviously, they didn't survive. And this one particular feature is the reason they didn't survive. It's because Adobe knew fonts and the other companies did not. PDF, as you know, supports the embedding of fonts. You can actually take the font data, stick it into the PDF, and it's carried along with the document and re-rendered on every other machine. These other people didn't understand that that was the right way to do fonts, and so they would turn your font data into bitmaps, rasterize it, or they would turn them into outlines, and then you couldn't search for on your text. So none of them truly got this right, and this is the reason the PDF won the war, because everybody wanted their text searchable and readable and scalable and all the things that we do to this day. I'll just point out, since it's here on the slide, I mentioned font embedding. You do not, of course, have to fully embed the font. We also support what's called subset embedding, which is where only the characters that you actually use within the font are included, and of course, that way your fonts are much, much smaller. The other thing that happens usually during the embedding process is the parts of a font that are not used later on are removed. For example, many fonts contain information that's useful during layout, such as kerning tables. When you're laying out the text, you need to know how to kern, how to put characters close together. But once it's laid out, you don't need that information anymore, and so it would waste space in the final PDF. And so the process of embedding and subsetting fonts would also remove tables such as a kerning table, which no longer serves a purpose in a final layout like PDF. Random access, we talked about this. Again, key difference between PostScript and PDF and the thing that really gave us that. There is one thing that's interesting here. So you may remember from that slide that the cross-reference table is at the end of the document. If that's where the catalog, where all of our object information is stored, that would imply that to read a PDF, you have to be able to get to the end of the document before you can start reading anything. And that's true. And that was fine until this thing called the internet came about. And it was a real problem when, in order for you to read your PDF, you had to download the entire document to your disk before you could view even the first page. And so back in PDF 1.3, so this is going back a long time now at this point, we introduced a feature that technically is called linearization. In the Acrobat user interface, we call it fast web view. And what it means is that we take that cross-reference table and we put a copy of it at the front of the document. And this way, when Acrobat, for example, sees your PDF coming over the line, and it sees that you've got that block of data, that linearization information in there, it can immediately display page one. And then, actually what happens in the background is while you're looking at page one, Acrobat is fetching pages 2, 3, 4, etc. So as soon as you go to that page, it's there. And this really improves your web experience. So the feature of fast web view enabling of linearization is something you want to ensure is in your documents, as a feature of your documents, if you're going to put them up on the web, because that is what is going to give you that clearly better web experience for your documents. So, there we go. So, I should point out, if anyone has any questions at any point, you are welcome to raise your hand, jump in, scream, whatever works for you.
Well,
yeah, go ahead.
There are lots of PDF generators around. Some of them have this feature and some don't?
That's correct. Yeah, and that will be true for all of the things I'm talking about today. Certainly, you know, Adobe, our products happen to do all of these things because we, you know, do it as we go along, but not everyone can keep up as well as we can, understandably. But yeah, so certainly every product is going to differ in its functionality. But this is what is available technically within PDF, the file format. Okay, so everything I talk about will be related to PDF, the file format, even if I use Acrobat as the specific example of how to get to it. Okay. Yes?
Was there ever any reason to have everything at the end? I mean, could you just change the DVs there so that it went at the front all the time?
Ah, good question. I'll answer it to you. So there's a reason why it was at the end in the first place. The reason why it was at the end in the first place, and also somewhat goes to why we didn't just move it, is that by having it at the end, you can create the file in stream, meaning that if it was at the beginning, you would have to build the entire PDF in memory and then write it out. By having it at the end, you can write as you go, and then, boom, drop your catalog at the end. So in, you know, small memory environments, large data, it was necessary to have a stream-based solution. So that's why it was done originally, to enable that feature, and it's one of the reasons we didn't throw it away, because we didn't want to lose that feature. The other reason is compatibility, and I actually think it somewhat mentions on the next slide. PDF is probably the only format in existence where version 8, so Acrobat, I'm just going to again use Acrobat here. Acrobat 8 can read a file created by Acrobat 1. Okay, so PDF 1.0 is still fully processed by our current version. That's nice, but we can also turn that around. If you could find a version of Acrobat 1.0, you could read an Acrobat 8 file with it. Okay, that's impressive. And we'll talk a little bit more about it. And that's part of the thing, is we don't break compatibility unless there's a really good reason. We've done it on a few occasions. So there are things that I could make with Acrobat 8 today, say newer compression algorithms that wouldn't be read by Acrobat 1, but there, we do that very, very carefully because we don't want to break that compatibility backwards. Okay, incremental update. This is actually a feature most people kind of stumble upon accidentally when they use Adobe Acrobat. If you open up a document in Acrobat and you make a change and you go File, Save, it happens really, really quickly. And what you don't notice is that your document gets larger and larger every time you do this. And the reason is that Acrobat has a, or excuse me, PDF has a feature called incremental update. So that every time there's a change, we can just tack on extra stuff at the end of the document without affecting your original document. So it means saves and updates are very quick, but your document grows because we're not collecting all of that garbage along the way. The advantage of this feature, of course, fast updating, it also theoretically provides a history so that under certain circumstances, you could provide a user interface to show all of the revisions that have taken place throughout the life of that document. And to my knowledge, Acrobat is the only product that does this, and only under one circumstance, if you digitally sign a document. From the point you digitally sign it, and then whatever you do, you can actually view every revision and every change to that document from the point of signing. Okay. So it does come in handy if you actually want to see any changes that have taken place to your document. Extensibility. So this is what I was just talking about, the ability for 1.0 and 8.0 to read each other's files. And the way it works has to do sort of with the way the objects are structured within the document, which I won't get into. But suffice it to say that if a PDF viewer does not understand a given object, it ignores it, or what I lovingly refer to as throws it on the floor. Okay, that's fine. We can add all sorts of new objects, and the older viewers just ignore them. And that works great. All right, so that's our key stuff. 10,000 foot view. Now I'd like to start delving down into some of these specific items. And certainly the most important one is the imaging model. Every page in PDF has a series of boxes that are associated with it. Every page in a PDF document is unique. So a lot of people tend to ask me, how do you determine the page size of a PDF? Well, the PDF document does not have a page size. Each page has its own size. So that you can actually have a document with a mixture of 8.5 by 11, A4, architectural B sizes, doesn't matter. Every page is unique in that regard. It has a physical size, what in PDF lingo we call the media box, and it has a viewable size, which has to be smaller than the physical size, which we call the crop box. It also has a few other special pre-press boxes, trim and bleed. But the whole point is every page is unique, has a physical size and a viewing size. And then whatever you're going to put on that page, just you throw it in and that's your content. One of the interesting things about how PDF works and that makes it easy for people to think about it is PDF objects, drawing objects, are described in what we call user space. This is how device independence is handled. How you can just put in stuff and it will draw correctly to a 72 DPI screen and to your 1200 DPI typesetter. Everything's described in user space, and if you remember that user space is theoretically 72 DPI. So if when you're describing objects to be put on a PDF page, you do it by thinking 72 DPI. So my page, an 8.5 by 11 page, 612 by 792 user units. 8.5 by 11 at 72 DPI. You want to put something at 1010? Fine. Or 1 inch by 1 inch, 72 by 72. Again, it's not really 72 DPI, but mentally, that model makes everything just work. Are you required to use that model? No. If, for example, you're an old school Windows programmer and you like TWIPs, those of you who have never heard of a TWIP, it's 14,400 units to an inch. That's a TWIP. Don't ask me why Windows does TWIPs, other than it's a cool name. Just say TWIP and impress your friends. But needless to say, if you like working in TWIPs, you can actually convert that user space into TWIPs and draw in TWIPs and everything just works. Your numbers are much bigger, granted, but mathematically and technically it all just works. One other thing that I like to point out is recently we've enlarged the size of a page. Up through PDF 1.6, up to 1.5 actually, the maximum size of a page was about 200 inches. Okay, which is a good size page for most people. It doesn't work very well for architectural people who want to put things on buses, for example, or very large billboards. So we enlarged it. So the new maximum is, I forget, it's approximately 237 miles. If any of you actually build a document with a page size that large, I'd love to see it and know what you're doing with it. But technically, be our guest. You can have very large pages. Color. This is one of my favorite areas. There are, interestingly enough, 11 different ways to describe the same color in PDF. I shouldn't say that. There are actually 9 ways to describe a color and then a couple of special color spaces. Why do we have that many different ways to describe color? Because there are lots of different people out there who see color differently. You might want to represent color in gray, in RGB, which is great for your screen. If you're a printer, you know about CMYK. If you're really into color, you might do what are called ICC profiles and use ICC profile-based color. If you're a real color geek, you use something called lab, L-A-B. And I'll tell you what lab is. This is not something you can go home and impress your friends with. So the whole idea of lab is to solve a problem that they call metamerism. Okay, and it's spelled just like it sounds. And metamerism is described in the following way. How many times have you woken up middle of the night, or you know, it's early in the morning, your spouse, significant other, roommate is still sleeping, you don't want to turn on the lights to wake them up, so you go and you choose your clothes while the room is dark, you know, your shirt, your pants, your socks, and then you walk out into the lit hallway and you look down and you go, oh my God, what was I thinking? Because your colors don't match. So why is it that they matched in the dark room and didn't match in the bright light? Or in this room with the ambient light here versus the sunlight outside. That is called scientifically metamerism. And all it means is colors look differently under different light. It's a really hard problem that color scientists have been trying to solve for years, and they solved it with lab. So lab colors actually let you describe a color in such a way that it doesn't matter what your light source is, your colors will always look the same. So lab colors kind of pull that way. We also support index colors and other things. The one other one I'll point out, because I happen to have my bottle of Diet Coke with me, which is what I always use when I do this part. So if you've ever looked at a Coca-Cola label, Diet Coke in this case, the red in the Coke is not red as you and I know it. It's not an RGB value. It's not a CMYK value. It's what's called a named color or a spot color. And ready for this name? It's called Coca-Cola Red. It's a very unique name. And as you see in my diagram, I have the FedEx logo, which of course is now the FedEx Kinko's logo, but the colors in the FedEx logo are also named colors. That's FedEx purple and FedEx orange. You can see they went to the same naming school as Coca-Cola did. But the fact is that you can have named colors. You may have heard of Pantone colors. Pantones are probably the most popular type of named color, and of course, PDF fully supports those. One other thing that's unique about PDF is that patterns and smooth shadings are also considered colors. And that means that anywhere that you can use a pattern, you can use, or anywhere you can use a plain color, like FedEx purple, you can also use a smooth shade. And you see the examples here of painting in the leaves, painting in a circle, but that also means you can use them for stroking as well, for the outer lines, so that there's no difference. They're treated 100% the same. We mentioned that transparency was introduced back in PDF 1.4. And it's not just simple transparency. We said if we're going to do it, we're going to do it right from the beginning. And we took our lessons from Photoshop, which at the time was the big transparency application within Adobe. So we start, of course, with basic alpha, what's called alpha blending, which the example of my Venn diagram in the upper right-hand corner, where each object simply says I'm 50% opaque or 50% transparent, depending on which way you go. But we also do things like blending modes. If you've ever used Photoshop and you do things like setting dodge, burn, lighten, darken, all of those are available within your PDF. Images can have masks, which are partially transparent. Honestly, every possible thing you could probably think you'd want to do with transparency or have ever done in something like Photoshop or the GIMP, you can do in PDF. And of course, it doesn't just work on raster graphics, it works on everything. So your text can be partially transparent, your vectors, you can group objects together. It's actually a very, very comprehensive set of transparency operations, which, to be honest, most people don't really use, which is a good thing also. It's kind of like fonts in the original Mac 128K, and people, you know, went really hog wild and picked every font. Fortunately, people are not doing that with transparency. Except for the example at the bottom, but it was supposed to be that way, so don't count that. All right, graphic objects. So nothing really shocking here. PDF supports all of the standard types of objects you'd expect. We have PAS, we have text, we have raster images. We have something called FormX objects, and I have a slide on it, but I'll mention it here. Basically, you can think of a FormX object. It's a fancy term for a PDF in a PDF. I'm simplifying it technically, but logically it's what it is. If, for example, you have something that repeats on every page, perfect example being the background of this slide. Okay? The background of this slide, the company copyright, the Adobe logo in the right-hand corner, are the same on every slide in this presentation, or I think 90% of every slide in this presentation. I don't want or need I think there's 40 slides in this presentation. I don't want 40 copies of that data. It's just going to blow up the size of my document. I want one copy, and I want to repeat it over and over and over again. And that is what a FormX object is all about. It says, record this one PDF set of operations and replay them on whatever page you want to use them. What's nice is that when you replay them, you're not limited to replaying them with the same coordinates. You can replay them at different sizes, different rotations. All of the standard transformations can be used as well. And so that comes in handy in certain types of content reuse. The other thing, and I'll talk more about this momentarily, are PostScript language fragments. We'll talk about the use of PostScript in PDF momentarily. Fonts. So I want to talk especially about fonts. That's certainly a topic I'm sure is near and dear to many of your hearts, since you're typesetting text a lot. So PDF supports every font format of, that would come out wrong. Okay, PDF supports every vector font format that is in major use today. All right, TrueType, Type1, OpenType. So all of the major outline or vector font formats. In addition, we support a mechanism which goes back to our PostScript heritage called Type3 fonts. Type3 fonts were actually invented specifically to address you folks in this room. They were invented to create a way to take meta fonts and historical bitmap fonts from tech and put them into PostScript and PDF so they could be represented correctly, because neither of those languages has supported a bitmap font. And so that's what a Type3 font is. It is literally a way to take a bitmap font, or actually any non-traditional style font type, like Type1, TrueType, OpenType, and represent them in PDF and PostScript. And of course, PDF fully supports them. It is equal. We do not treat any one font type any differently than another font type. They're all created equal, as it were. Okay. To that end, we actually have changed something. Then this is actually an Acrobat change. It's never something that was said to be a PDF feature. This was actually something that was an Acrobat-specific thing that people thought was PDF-related. Acrobat, up through Acrobat version 5, used to do what we called special case the base 14 fonts. This is the Courier family, the Times family, the Helvetica family, Symbol, and Dingbats. The assumption was that you did not have to embed those fonts because every copy of Acrobat and from then other PDF viewers had them along for the ride, and you were guaranteed to get the right font. Well, the fact of the matter was that really actually was not happening right, because our Mac version was carrying a different font than the Windows version was, so you weren't getting the right thing. The Windows 6 version and Windows 5 version were carrying different fonts, and it just wasn't working. And we said, you know what? There's no reason to special case these. We are going to treat them like any other non-embedded font. And so from the Acrobat standpoint, we now treat all fonts literally as equal. If it's embedded, we handle it as an embedded font. If it's non-embedded, we handle it as a non-embedded font, and we look for a substitution. And that's it. There are no special fonts as far as Acrobat is concerned. That said, other PDF viewers like GoScript, XPDF, KPDF, whatever it is, may still choose to implement this particular feature. That's fine. There's nothing wrong with special casing. Acrobat does not do that any longer, and it is not a feature of PDF. So, font embedding. One of the other questions I always get asked when I talk about font embedding, so I'll raise it, is what if I can't embed my font? The two reasons why, one is technical and one is legal. Technical is simple. Certain font types, specifically TrueType and OpenType fonts, have a flag in them that says, I can be embedded or I cannot be embedded. It actually says, and how I can be embedded. But TrueType ones do not have this option. So technically, if your font has this flag set, Acrobat or any other PDF production tool should respect that flag. We do, not everybody does, but they should. And makes the document and will refuse to embed that font. That's pretty obvious. The other one's a little more complex because it involves lawyers, and therefore by definition it's more complex. That is that you can have what's called, your font can come with a EULA, an end user license agreement, that says you may not embed this font. Even though technically you can, my lawyer says that you can't. So how do you deal with this? I'll tell you the story. Before I worked for Adobe, I had my own company. And my graphic artist created my company logo using a font that she thought looked really nice. What she didn't bother to check, though, was that the font was not legally embeddable. So here I am running a company doing PDF software, and I can't embed my own corporate logo. Okay, this was not working really well. So I called the font vendor, and I didn't want to get my graphic artist mad. So I called the font vendor, and I said, I would really like to embed this font in the document. What do I have to do? And like every good American, he said, send me $20 and I'll send you a new license agreement. And so $20 later, I can now embed my font. Did it change the font on my disk? No. Did I have a new EULA? Yes. So we learned from this is that money talks, and that basically you just have to be aware of these two things. Okay. Formex objects we've talked about, so I won't spend any more time there. I do want to talk about PostScript fragments. This is something that some people have done historically, and yes. Excellent question. Usually the answer to that question is that the font vendor, the person who created the font, wants to make, well, some of it is historical. The bottom line is they want to make more money. They think that if it can't be embedded in the PDF, or if it can, I should take this the other way. If the font can be embedded in a PDF, then when I send it to you, you can take the font out of the PDF, install it in your operating system, and now you have a copy of the font. So they saw PDF as a font copying and distribution mechanism, and so they would lose money. The fact of the matter is it doesn't work that way. When a font is embedded, the normal mechanism, now certainly you could take every bit of that font off my disk, stick it in the PDF, send it to you, and if you had an appropriate tool, and there aren't any around, but theoretically if you had one, you could then extract it, dump it in your fonts directory and use it. However, the process by which fonts are embedded by most embedding tools, and this includes not only Acrobat, but PDF Tech, all of them, you know, XPDF and GoScript, all of the major PDF production tools and libraries out there, actually, as I mentioned earlier, strip out a whole bunch of pieces of that font, making it unusable in your operating system. You can try it. It won't work because, first of all, you're not going to have all of the characters. You're only going to have, say, A, E, I, O, and U, which is going to make your documents really small, you know, what you can actually type with it. But it may also just not even be viewable. A lot of times Windows, for example, will say this is not a valid font if you actually try to do this. So in reality, there isn't any reason other than these people have historical bias against PDF as a font distribution mechanism. It's all, you know, it's all about the almighty dollar, no matter how you slice it. Okay. Oh, PostScript fragments. So basically, PDF as a language supports the, thank you. Oh boy. So much for really getting through this. Okay. PostScript fragments. So you can have PostScript embedded in the PDF. However, it will not do what you expect it to do because no PDF viewer will actually render it on the screen. And you're not guaranteed that it will even actually go out to your printer. So as they used to say about other things, just say no to this particular feature. Good. Oh, I can get the optional content. So optional content is a feature that was introduced in PDF 1.5. And it's probably something most of you haven't seen, but I think it's really cool. It's the ability to have parts of your document only show up at certain times. For example, you want some text that only shows up when printed but not on the screen, or something on the screen but not when you print. Or maybe I want text that only shows up when I see it, but Nelson will never see it. Okay? You can have it associated with user IDs. You can have it associated with zooming. This is one of my favorites. A map. Think about a map that as you get closer in, as you zoom in on the map, more information becomes available. Okay? This is optional content. In the Acrobat user interface, they show us layers, which was a really bad username for them. This is why optional content is a much better name. Lots of pre-pressed stuff, which I won't talk about. All right, so since I only have a few minutes, I'm going to skip the entire second half of this presentation. But you have copies of it, and I will be around, and you're all welcome to ask me any questions, and I apologize. I have never gotten through this presentation, no matter how much time anybody ever gives me. I never get through this presentation. But I do want to cover one last, I do actually want to jump to the end of the presentation very briefly, because I want to talk about one thing. That one. Okay. So I mentioned earlier about the fact that we've taken PDF as the entire language to ISO as an open standard. That actually will become the umbrella of a series of other PDF standards that exist out there. And I want to introduce these to you in case you've not heard of them. There are three standards already in existence created by the International Standards Organization around PDF for specific vertical uses. The first one was PDFX. X stands for exchange. It's about pre-press exchange. So if you're doing PDF documents that are going to be used as advertisements, placed in magazines, things in which you're doing high-end pre-press types of work, you want to be using PDFX. That's what it was designed for. A lot of places in the US, mostly groups like Time Inc. If you want to submit an ad to Sports Illustrated, for example, you have to send the PDFX file. In Europe, it's even more prevalent. So that's PDFX. PDFA is a relatively recent standard. It was released in 2005. A stands for archiving. In this case, we're talking long-term archiving. Some people think that's 5 years, 10 years, 50 years, 100 years. My two favorite examples, though, the NARA, the National Archives here in the US, is required by law to maintain documents, quote, until the end of the Republic, unquote. Okay, so. You could translate that into as long as you feel appropriate, but that gives you an idea of what long-term means to some people. Okay, so that's PDFA, that's real long-term archiving. The other one, which actually we just went final on 3 weeks ago, I was in London 3 weeks ago, we went final on this, PDFE. It's for engineering, architecture, building, construction, anything in that genre, and it really enables live workflows of rich documents with 3D CAD measurements, security workflow, etc. And then the other one, yes, 1 minute, I know I'm wrapping up, thank you. This, the one that is the furthest behind all of these is PDF UA, which is about user accessibility and universal access. And the idea here is to take PDF and make it more accessible to people who are not, do not have all of the facilities, blind, deaf, their fingers or whatever are not able to use the keyboards as well, so we want to make it as available. And one of the things that's going on in that group that's relevant to this group is the bringing of MathML directly into PDF. So we're looking as a way to bring MathML as a native object type into PDF. So I'll mention that. So thank you. I apologize that we only got through about half of the presentation, but as I said, I'll be around, then please feel free to ask me whatever you want. Yes, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Will we no longer have PostScript centers and we'll have PDF printers?
Well, those are two different questions. I'll take the second half. Are there native PDF printers? Yes. About a year ago, Adobe introduced something called the PDF Print Engine, which is something we are providing to all of our OEMs so that PDFs go right in and they print natively. There's no PostScript, there's no conversion. Does that mean the PostScript printers are going away? To be honest, that's not a question we can answer. It's a question of vendors like Xerox and HP and everybody who produces the printers. We will continue to provide a PostScript rip for as long as our OEMs want it. We're not killing it. We are moving, giving them options, but we're not killing it. Yes?
The embedding on the .ml, is that not just metadata, which you didn't cover, or is that?
It's actually done via a mechanism called tagging and structure, which I didn't mention, but which is the basis for accessibility within a PDF. And I can talk to you more about the details. I'll go across the back. Yes, to the left. Yes. Ah, good. That's an excellent point. And as part of the process of taking these standards to ISO, we have made arrangements with ISO that all PDF standards will be available for free from ISO. Yes. We agree. Yes. That was one of the things that we had to make sure was in place before we did this. Yes. Totally agree. And I'm glad you raised that. No, actually, the bottom line is we've actually been talking about doing this for a number of years now. It's not new. We actually, every time we rev Acrobat and we rev PDF, we say, you know what, are we ready to turn it over yet? Are we ready to turn it over yet? We finally got to the point where we said, you know what, we're pretty much done with, not that we're done with it, that's not true, we have lots of ideas, but we've taken it as far as we think we want to take it, and we really want other people to start bringing their things in. Is it, I mean, certainly one could say that that was a factor that was over our heads. Was it the thing that made us do it? No. We've been talking about doing it for years. But yes, it was something that we sat there and went, okay, this is something we have to consider. But it was not like the top of the list to be honest. But yeah, it was there. I can't argue about that.
Okay.
And then I'll go left. You know, somebody asked me that exact same question yesterday. No, it's good. It's an excellent question. So obviously, we make Reader available on Linux, Solaris, AIX. Actually, we're currently shipping 7, and I believe that either this week or next we go live with 8. I know it's done. I know that. Now, so that's Reader. So that's part one. So we do make Reader available on 4 or 5 different Unix platforms.
But late.
We're working on it. We're getting better. We're working on it. Okay. The full Acrobat, I'll be honest with you, we did Acrobat 4 or 5 was actually available for Solaris.
Five, yes.
Yes. Yeah. I understand that. Okay. We did it. We tried it. I'll be honest with you that strictly from a money point of view, we did not recoup our investment. Okay. Granted, we're a big public company and it's... What's that? And that is why we have Reader on every platform, including my cell phone, for that matter, runs Reader. Okay, we agree. The issue is, and I'm not saying we shouldn't do it. Personally, I agree with you, okay? I have Linux boxes in my office. I love it myself. I've been using it, you know, that and other Unix platforms for years. The fact of the matter is that high enough up in the corporate structure, we have to convince them that the ROI, the return on investment, is worthwhile. And I will tell you this, if someone or enough people come to us and say, if you know, I will buy 100, 200, some number of copies of Acrobat on Linux, Acrobat on Solaris, whatever it is, okay, if that number is high enough, and I honestly don't know what that number is, but if that number is large enough, we will do it. It's not hard. All of our code compiles across all the platforms. We do it every day. It's shipping the solution, QAing it, testing it, and everything else that goes into it.
Market, we're not going to produce a shrink wrap box that's in the store. We're going to have a web solution.
It's not the box. That's not even, that's trivial anymore. It's honestly, it's key, it's the testing resources. You're preaching to the choir, believe me. I'm one of the first people in line when we have this argument internally as well. So I'm on your side. I'm just trying to, and I will, I'm just trying to tell you what they tell me when I do this. Is there,
I think there's only time for one more question.
You pick it. Okay, you're fine. Sorry.
You could sell it for Linux without a warranty, then you wouldn't have to test it.
Okay, but I'm not running it.